Everybody. Today, I'm going to share with you one situation which we have commonly experienced at shopping centers where we can walk right through the building because the glass doors open as we near it. Then there's the other case, which I hope you have not experienced, where you have bumped right into the door thinking that the door will open, but it didn't. Now, these two situations are similar to what happens at the plasma membrane. When the plasma membrane is permeable, the molecules can move right through the membrane, like in this video. Whereas when the membrane is impermeable, the molecule bounces back because it is unable to enter. In my previous discussion on the steroid hormone, the movement of the steroid hormone is just like this man walking right through the plasma membrane because it is small and lipid soluble. So it can diffuse into the cell and bind with the receptor to form a hormone receptor complex. Now, today's video, I'm going to talk about another type of hormone known as the peptide hormone. And the poor peptide hormone suffers the same problem as in this video, where it is unable to diffuse across the membrane. So let's watch the video to understand this process further. This time, I'm going to cover the second part of the syllabus that is related to non-steroid hormones. Non-steroid hormones are also known as peptide hormones since they are made up of polypeptides. They are large since they are proteins and they are, of course, water soluble, meaning that they are lipid insoluble. These molecules cannot cross the phospholipid bilayer. And because of that, their mechanism of action is completely different from that of the steroid hormone, and its effect is short-term, whereby the effect of the hormone can only last between minutes or at maximum few hours. We now have a look at examples of non-steroid hormones. There are many. I'll introduce a few here. Starting off with thyroxine, secreted by the thyroid gland, it helps to regulate our metabolism. Then you have glucagon and insulin, both of which are secreted by the pancreas to regulate our blood glucose levels. Adrenal gland will synthesize adrenaline, which helps in the flight or fight response. And you must remember, adrenal gland also secretes steroid hormones like cortisol and aldosterone. So memorize these examples carefully so that you do not confuse examples of steroid hormones and example of a non-steroid hormone. The pituitary gland, which is the master gland, secretes many hormones. I only named three here: the FSH, follicle stimulating hormone; LH, the luteinizing hormone; and ADH, the antidiuretic hormone. So these hormones are also non-steroid hormones. Okay, however, FSH and LH are related to reproduction. So do not make the careless mistake of thinking that steroid hormones are involved in reproduction, so FSH and LH also should be steroid. No. The steroid hormones are the hormones secreted by the testes and the ovary. FSH and LH, although related to reproduction, are synthesized by the pituitary gland. So that's why FSH and LH are non-steroid hormones. Now, the basic mechanism of action of a non-steroid hormone or peptide hormone is similar to that of a steroid hormone. Here I use a specific example. Let's say we focus on the pancreas that secretes the hormone insulin. So insulin will be transported into the blood vessel, and the blood will transport the insulin to its target organ, that is the liver. And naturally, the insulin will bind to the receptor found on the liver cells to start off the mechanism of action. But we will now move on to see the difference between the mechanism of action in a peptide hormone compared to a steroid hormone. This is the cell diagram I've used previously in the steroid hormone discussion. And this is the hormone insulin, which is a non-steroid hormone. And it's important to remember these two characteristics. The fact that because it is made of a polypeptide, it is going to be a large molecule and it is water soluble, and that means it is lipid insoluble. So when this hormone wants to try to diffuse across the plasma membrane, it cannot, okay, because it is not lipid soluble. So what happens, you see, is the receptor for this hormone is located on the plasma membrane, unlike steroid hormones. In the case of steroid hormone action, the receptor can be either in the cytoplasm or in the nucleoplasm because the steroid hormone can diffuse into the cell. But in the case of a non-steroid hormone, since it cannot diffuse, therefore the receptor is located on the plasma membrane. So the hormone will bind to the receptor that is on the plasma membrane and form the hormone receptor complex. Now, since the hormone cannot enter the cell, non-steroid hormones are also known as the primary messenger or the extracellular messenger. So now, how does the function of the insulin get transported into the cell when the hormone cannot enter? Let me explain further. Now, this is a detailed diagram of the plasma membrane with the receptor for insulin here. Now, on the inner side of the plasma membrane, there are two other proteins that I want to introduce to you. One is the inactive G protein that is attached to the receptor, and we have an inactive adenylate cyclase enzyme located nearby. So what happens when the insulin binds to the receptor and forms the hormone receptor complex? It will actually activate the G protein, okay, and the G protein now will be able to move towards the inactive adenylate cyclase. When the active G protein binds to the inactive adenylate cyclase, the adenylate cyclase enzyme now becomes activated. So let's see what an activated adenylate cyclase can do. The activated adenylate cyclase will start to carry out enzymatic reaction, that is, it will actually catalyze the conversion of ATP into a molecule called cyclic AMP, CAMP for short. Now, this cyclic AMP, you can see, is going to be in the cytoplasm of the cell. So, the cyclic AMP is known as the secondary messenger or the intracellular messenger, because cyclic AMP is going to carry out the instructions that was brought by insulin. So insulin is staying outside here as the extracellular messenger, but it is the primary messenger. But the job now has been passed to the intracellular messenger, CAMP, which will function as the secondary messenger. So let's move on to see what the secondary messenger can do. The cytoplasm of cells will have a number of proteins inside them, such as a group of enzymes called the protein kinase in an inactive form. Now, enzymes that end with the name kinase are enzymes that can carry out phosphorylation. I introduced this group of enzymes to you when in semester 1 in the topic of cellular respiration. Kinase enzymes are enzymes that can either add or remove phosphate from a molecule. Now, other than this group of enzymes, we also have general enzymes. They are not specific in function. There are many different types of enzymes or proteins in the cytoplasm that remain inactive. So what happens next is the secondary messenger, cyclic AMP, will start off by activating the protein kinase. So once the protein kinase has been activated, it will carry out enzymatic process by phosphorylating specific enzymes and proteins. It does this by adding inorganic phosphate to the enzyme or the protein. In doing so, it will activate the enzyme or the protein. So we are going to use a specific example. Insulin, if you remember, functions to convert excess glucose in our blood to glycogen. So the insulin hormone will cause the cyclic AMP to activate the protein kinase, and the protein kinase will go on to activate enzymes that can convert excess glucose into glycogen. So in other examples, the enzymes and proteins will do other functions as required by the hormone. For example, if the hormone ADH, antidiuretic hormone, then the activated enzyme or activated protein will function as a transport channel at the membrane of the nephron to reabsorb water. We find that the activated enzyme or activated protein can also become structural proteins. For example, growth hormones are peptide hormones, so they are required to build muscle in our body. So the activated protein will become a structural protein in the form of a muscle. So as I said previously in my steroid hormone video, it is good for you to know the type of hormone and its physiological function so that when you are explaining in an essay, at the final stage when you mention that the enzyme or protein is phosphorylated, you can give the correct example to support. Now, just a little bit more on the non-steroid hormone. Its mechanism of action has another name. It's called the cascade action. Cascade action is a series of reactions in which the product of one reaction will then catalyze the next reaction. As I explain the summary of the non-steroid hormone's action, you will see this cascade action taking effect. Firstly, you see the non-steroid hormone binds to the protein receptor located on the plasma membrane to form a hormone receptor complex. So the hormone receptor complex is the product. But this hormone receptor complex is able to convert the inactive G protein to become an active G protein. So the hormone receptor complex behaves like an enzyme by converting the inactive G protein into active G protein. Now, the active G protein behaves like an enzyme by converting the inactive adenylate cyclase into active adenylate cyclase. Then, the active adenylate cyclase is going to catalyze the conversion of ATP into cyclic AMP, which is now the product. But cyclic AMP will behave like an enzyme by helping to convert the inactive protein kinase into active protein kinase. And then the active protein kinase will convert the inactive proteins or inactive enzymes through the process of phosphorylation to become active enzyme or active protein. So you can see each step is dependent on the other. That is what we call as a cascade action. With that, I have come to the end of our discussion on the mechanism of action of the non-steroid hormones. So I'll see you in my next video. Bye-bye.